Welcome to the weekly webcast. Each week, these messages are brought to you with practical help for daily living from our teacher and pastor, John S. Terrell. Our hope is that you'll be encouraged and challenged by this message and that you share it with a friend. This morning, Pastor John continues a series entitled, The Destiny of Humanity. As the Godhead was in the process of designing the creation, they knew the redemption plan for the human race would not be acceptable to Lucifer and his fallen angels. God foresaw that Satan would introduce scores of false messiahs to hinder mankind from accepting Jesus as their Lord and Savior. In order to make sure there was no confusion, God provided a number of specific details so that Jesus could be identified as the Messiah when he finally arrived. The only thing God did not reveal was the year in which the Son of God would come. Meanwhile, the devil created chaos and lured the Jewish people into his fold by using demon-possessed men at different times to falsely declare that they were the Messiah. This message is entitled, 14 Prophecies About the Messiah. Now, let's join Pastor John as he begins today's message.
Praise the Lord, and welcome to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church Worldwide. And I'm going to be speaking today about prophecies about the Messiah. And I hope that I will blow your socks off today with what I'm going to be sharing with you. So let's pray right now. My Heavenly Father, I want to thank you, I want to praise you right now for this opportunity to share the Word of God. And Lord, to bring out truth to people, Father God, not only in America, but in many other nations. And I pray for an anointing upon myself and an anointing, Father God, on each person listening and watching. In Jesus' name, amen. Let me say something to you, YouTube listener. We have a lot of YouTube listeners. You go to YouTube, but you never go to our website. Remember this, I'm able to come your way because people are supporting us. So if you are a YouTube watcher, will you consider also to send a donation to us to keep us going and to keep expanding? So I thank you very much for that. And also, if you live in the greater Sacramento area, you might live from Auburn, you might live up in Marysville, Yuba City, you might live down in Vallejo, Stockton, some other places. We have a local church here in the greater Sacramento area. Right now, this broadcast is coming from our chapel. And we want to have people come. If you're local, and you say, do they have a church? Yes, we do have a church. And we meet on Sunday mornings. We would like to have you come. So contact us, and you will tell us where we are located, and we will invite you. So we want to have local people coming to be part of our church. So notice, you are more than welcome. Last week, I talked about God, the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, that they are eternal. Everything was predestined. They can go in time. They are simply not bound by anything. They are all-knowing. And let me read to you from my outline. God wanted to make sure he provided enough evidence in advance so that no one could say that Jesus was not the Messiah. Satan read the prophecies. He heard the prophecies when they were given to the prophets through evil spirits that repeated them back to him. The devil reads the Bible. He knows the Bible inside out. He can quote any verse to you. He knows it all. And he knows that God goes by this. He's trying to counter it. Now Satan read a message of God to his prophets, and he knew that the Messiah would eventually come. In order to create chaos and lure the Jewish people into his fold. He used different demon-possessed men to proclaim their messiahship. When God did the creation, and Jesus was selected to be the Lamb of God, slain for the foundation of the world, Satan knew that the Messiah would come. He said, fine, if God's going to have a Messiah, I'm going to have one. I'm going to have many. And when God looked down in time, in the future, he saw all these things happening. And God simply said this, in order for us to make sure that the Son of God, Jesus Christ, will be recognized, we have to give credentials. So beginning with Jesus speaking to Adam and Eve, that there will be a crushing of the serpent's head, there will be a coming Redeemer. And then to the different prophets, God laid out information saying, all these pieces must fit together, and when they are converging on one person, notice that is the real Messiah. In the book of Acts, chapter 5, and verse number 34, prior to Jesus, there had been a number of men who had proclaimed to be the Messiah. I want to take you away, particularly if you live in America. I want to strip away your American Christianity. Don't take our culture and try to put Jesus in it. Go to the culture that Jesus lived in, Israel. Now, the people in Israel at that time, they were occupied by the Romans. And they had their synagogues, they had their temple. And prior to Jesus, several men had come and said, I am the Messiah. And they got people working with them. And each one of them were executed. So let me read. We have this history now from the book of Acts. Then stood there up one of the council, a Pharisee named Gamaliel, a doctor of the law, had a reputation among the people, and commanded to put the apostle forth of the space. And he said unto the Jewish leadership now, you men of Israel, take heed to yourself what you intend to do as touching these men. For before these days rose up Thoidas, boasting himself to be somebody, to a number of men, about 400, joined themselves, who were slain, and all as men obeyed him were scattered and brought to naught. Here was a man. He said, I'm the Messiah. He died. He was not resurrected. After this man rose up Judas of Galilee, in the days of the taxing, and drew away much people after him, he also perished, and all, even as many as obeyed him, were dispersed. Judas of Galilee had thousands of followers, and he was executed. He did not be resurrected. Do you understand now that the people living at that time, here comes Jesus now, and they said, here's the Messiah. And people says, well, what about Thoidas? What about Judas? What about this guy? What about that guy? Jesus is just one in a bunch. Do you get the picture now? The people had a hard time to believe because there had been so many messiahs. And that's why the disciples asked Jesus, who are you? That's why John the Baptist said, he sent his disciples to Jesus and said, are you sure? Are you the one coming? Are you sure? So God had to prove himself that Jesus was the Messiah. And I was saying to you, refrain from these men and let them alone. For if this counsel or this work it be of men, it will come to naught. But if it be of God, you cannot overthrow it, lest happen you be found even to fight against God. Gamaliel was a smart cookie. He said, this might be of God, this might not be. But he knew the miracles. He knew about the miracles. He had heard about the resurrection. He saw the boldness of the apostles. And he simply said, you know, this looks like it was the Messiah. If it is, it will spread. If not, it will be like Judas and Thoidas and the rest of them. It will die. Well, Christianity did spread, didn't die, because Jesus is the real thing. In your outline now, I want to show you, and this is something that I had not really put together before. I would say this, that most of you that are Christian do not know this. But we have here a number of men that have said, I am the Messiah. And I want to read a list to you here and talk about it briefly. The first one that came on up after Jesus was resurrected was Simon Bar Kokhba. And by the way, the Hebrew word bar means son. This was Simon, the son of Kokhba. He was killed in a battle during the attempt to stab the kingdom of Israel in 135 AD. How many Jews died? Approximately close to 1 million Jews, men, women, and children, were killed by the Romans as they put this rebellion down. These people believed that Simon was the Messiah. They fought for him. They died for him. And they went to hell. The next one that came up was Moses of Crete. He lived between 440 and 470. And this guy said, I'm the Messiah. We got a new deal. He lived on Crete as an island. He told the Jews, we're going to go down into the Mediterranean Sea. We're going to walk on the bottom of the sea to Israel and establish the kingdom of Israel. Well, he was a false yo-yo. It fizzled out, and people died and went to hell. The next one up was Isaac ben Jacob. He was around 684 to 705. He lived in Persia. And in Persia, they had about 1 million Jews. It was the Babylon and Persia. And he simply said, I'm the Messiah. Thousands followed him. He died. They died. They went to hell. David Elroy was born in Kurdistan and tried to convince the Jews that he was a Messiah. He was killed in 1160, another false man. David Rabini, in the 15th century, Solomon Mulcher, at the same time, worked together in Portugal, Italy, Turkey, declaring himself to be the Messiah, plural, failed, died. Sabbatai Siva, he's a crown jewel of them. 1626 to 1676, proclaimed himself to be the Messiah in 1666, was supported by the prophet Nathan of Gaza. The Sabbatian movement is still alive today, 2019. They still have followers among the Jews. He died, went to hell, and took his followers with him. Jacob Corrido, from 1650 to 1690, claimed that he was the incarnation of Sabbatai Sivai. He operated in Greece and Egypt. Miguel Cardoso, 1626-1706, took the title Messiah ben Ephraim, Messiah the son of Ephraim. He operated in Egypt, North Africa. He died and went to hell. Judah Leibler Prosnitz, 1670-1750, took the name Messiah, son of Joseph. He worked in Germany, Austria, Hungary, got a lot of followers. He died. He took his followers with him to hell. Jacob Frank. Jacob Frank followers now. We have still that with us today. That's the Kabbalah. Proclaimed he was a reincarnation of Sabbatai Sivai and Jacob, the son of Isaac. He's the one that simply said, the more we sin, he pushed that. The more we sin, the faster the serpent comes up. He's an ugly man. He died, went to hell, and took his followers with him. Joseph Yitzchak Schneerson, 1920-1950. This guy came from Belarus, which is also called White Russia. Belarus is next to Ukraine, and it used to be an independent state until the communists took it and controlled it. It's independent right now, but it's controlled by Russia. Schneerson said, hey, I'm the Messiah. He founded Shabbat. That was a synagogue in San Diego that got shot up. That's a Shabbat synagogue. That's the Lubavitchers. Now he died, went to hell. And then we have Menachem Mendel Schneerson, 1902 to 1994. Was the seventh and the last Rebbe of Shabbat Lubavitch. They have leadership there now. Now, the last one, Menachem, everybody said he is the Messiah. He has a grave site in New York, Jewish synagogue. If you Google that man, and see all the stuff, they put petitions, prayers. It's just like a mountain of paper prayers on top of it. That's where Jared Kushner go with Ivanka. That's where they go to pray. And that's what Jared Kushner is waiting for. This man, Menachem, he's going to be raised up as a Messiah. Shabbat is the biggest Jewish organization in the United States. They got lots of money. They do charities. They have synagogue, and they actually, the Kabbalistic synagogues that are visible. They are also Kabbalistic synagogues. Menachem had a lot of influence. In about 1988, Education Day USA was named after Schneerson. He also went and had an audience with his buddies, with the black hats on. And he met with President George H.W. Bush in the White House. And this is where they established the Noahide laws. And they got a resolution. And they got them in the Congress recorded. It's not law, but they got them as a resolution. It's a beginning. So the last one here, Menachem Mendel Schneerson, is still active, and he's dead. He's in hell. He's roasting. But his followers, just like the Mormons, pushing Joseph Smith and Brigham Young, just like any other false religion, they're pushing it. It's a false movement. Do you understand now why Jewish people are not excited when you tell them about Jesus and the Messiah. They said, so what? We had a whole bunch of them. They all came. They all said this. They all took our money. They all died. So what? What about this Jesus now? Understand now why the Jewish people have been vaccinated to understand who the real Messiah is. Go to the back page of my outline now. Prophecies about the Messiah. The coming of Jesus was foretold by God through the prophets. He was given several names like the Son of Man, the Redeemer, the Messiah, which means the Anointed One. And I want to begin to look at some of these. We got 14 here. Some of them I might spend some time on, and some of them I might just mention to you. But let's start in Job, chapter 19. That's the book of Job, the 19th chapter. Job chapter 19. The understanding that Job had, who was a contemporary with Abraham, he had read the book of Enoch, or the books of Enoch. And in the books of Enoch, we are told about the Son of Man. This was done about 600 years after Adam, in the middle of the time before the flood. And he also told about the coming judgment. And so there's a lot about the Messiah in the book of Enoch. And so now, Job is making a statement here. Oh, that my words were now written. Oh, that they were printed in the book. They were graven with an iron pen and laid in the rock forever. For I know that my Redeemer lives. He shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. And after my skin worms destroyed his body, yet in my flesh shall I see God, whom I shall save myself, and my eyes shall behold, and not another, till my reins be consumed within me. What a statement. Here is Job, living outside Israel, have this understanding for the book of Enoch, proclaiming the coming Messiah. He said, I might die. My body will still be destroyed. Worms will eat me. But in the end time, I will stand in myself. I will see with my eyes my Redeemer, who lives now. That's what he said. He lives now. When Job was here, of course, Jesus was alive. Let's turn to Psalm 16. Psalm 16. And we get another prophecy here about Jesus. Verses 16. And I'm going to go and read just verse number 10 to save time. And actually, you can read from Psalm 16, 8 through 11. For you will not leave my soul in hell, neither will you suffer your Holy One to see corruption. This is prophesied that when the Messiah would come, he would die, but he will not see corruption. He will not decay. And then if you turn to Jeremiah, chapter 31, that Jeremiah, chapter 31, Jeremiah chapter 31 and verse number 31. Behold, the days come, says the Lord, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. This was spoken about 500 years before Christ. And God told the prophet now, the old covenant is going to be replaced. There's a new covenant. It'll be covenant with the Messiah. In Psalm chapter 22, that's Psalms, the 22nd chapter, if you pick it up here, from verse number 14 and 18. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. Jesus had 39 lashes, tremendous breathing. He was hurt. My heart is like wax. It is melted in the midst of my bowels. My strength is dried up like a potsherd. My tongue clings to my jaws. And you have brought me into the dust of death. Remember reading when he went from Pilate to go to Golgotha? They put a crossbeam on him. He couldn't carry it. He fell down. They had Simon of Cyrene to carry it. And Jesus dragged himself to the cross. For dogs have come past me. The assembly of the wicked have enclosed me. They pierced my hands and my feet. His hands pierced with nails. His feet put together on the cross with a big nail. I might tell all my bones, they look and stare upon me. They part my garments among them and cast lots upon my vesture. Jesus had an expensive robe, one piece. And we do know from the New Testament, the soldiers cast lot and they gambled to see who would get the robe. This was fulfilled by the time when Jesus came to this earth. In Psalm 118, we read this in verse number 22. The stone which the builders refused to become the headstone of the corner. We know in John chapter 1, it says that Jesus came to his own received him not. Jesus became the cornerstone, the stone that was rejected by the builders, prophesied in advance. And then we turn to Isaiah chapter 61. That's Isaiah chapter 61. And we pick it up in verses 1 through 3. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of prison to them that are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all that mourn, to appoint unto them that mourn in Zion, to give unto them beautiful ashes, the oil of joyful mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they might be called trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he might be glorified. This is prophesied. God spoke this to Isaiah about 700 years before Christ. I want us to turn to, right now there's a bonus scripture for you here, to the Gospel of Luke chapter 4. That's the Gospel of Luke, and we're going to go to the fourth chapter. Luke chapter 4. And we're going to pick it up in verse 16. And he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, but as his custom was. He went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up for to read. This is Jesus' name. They delivered unto him the book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he opened the book, he found a place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord." And he closed the book and gave it again to the minister and sat down. and the eyes of all the land that were in the synagogue were fastened on him. And he began to say unto them, This day is the scripture fulfilled in your ears. And all to bear him witness and wondered at the gracious word which proceeded out of his mouth. And he said, Is not this Joseph's son? And then we go down to verse number 28. And all day in the synagogue, when they heard these things, were filled with wrath. When the Jewish people in that synagogue heard Jesus saying this, they were filled with wrath and rose up, thrust him out of the city, led him unto the brow of the hill whereon the city was built, that they might cast him down headlong. But he, passing through the midst of them, went his way. Do you understand now why the Jews had such a hard time to accept Jesus? There had been too many before him, too many imposters. And then we look upon the next prophecy, Isaiah chapter 7. Isaiah chapter 7. And we pick it up in verse number 14. Therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. Bread and honey shall he eat, that he may know to refuse the evil and choose the good. Wow, what a prophecy. Has a virgin give birth? This was written down 700 years before Christ. They did not know what we know today. Today is a piece of cake. You can take a virgin woman. They can go and pick some eggs out of her supplies, take them outside, fertilize them in the laboratory, put them back in her again, and she's pregnant. A virgin. No problem. But you see, 700 years before Christ, they did not even have electricity. They did not even know what an airplane was. They didn't even know what a telephone was. They didn't have anything. But God simply said, a virgin. Mary was a virgin. Supernaturally, she became pregnant through the Holy Spirit. I'm old enough to remember when I was in seminary from 1969 to 73, this was before they had learned to take eggs out and fertilize them from women. And the professors were simply saying it as, you know, a virgin giving birth like this, you know, that's just not true. That's just figuratively speaking. Of course, she got pregnant by Joseph. Well, these professors most likely are dead now in a nursing home. But you know, they're going to have to eat their words because they spew unbelief out to young men in the seminary at that time. And I remember telling them, if the Bible says it, I believe it. Shut up. That's it. Now go to Hosea. Chapter 11. That's the little book of Hosea. Chapter 11. Sorry, folks. Hope you can stay awake for me. Hosea. Chapter 11. Verse 1. When Israel was a child, then I loved him and called my son out of Egypt. Turn to Matthew 2:15. By the way, Hosea lived and worked, we give it a time, in actually between 748 and 670. So he was a contemporary with Isaiah. And about 700 years before, God said, I'm going to call him out of Egypt. In Matthew 2:15, we read the following. at Matthew chapter 2, verse number 15. And he was there unto the death of Herod. Let's read verse 14. When he arose, he took the young child mother by night and departed to Egypt, and was there unto the death of Herod, that he might be fulfilled what was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, out of Egypt have I called my son. Another prophecy, 700 years. Now, if you take all these prophecies, we got 14 of them here. There's more, we got 14. And you lay them out, and they all agree on Jesus. We have a sure word of God that Jesus was and is the Messiah. Amen. Let's turn to Isaiah chapter 53. That's Isaiah chapter 53. And let me get to Isaiah. There we go. Isaiah 53. And we're going to read from verses 1 through 10. This is a longer one. Who has believed our report? To whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, as a root out of a dry ground. He has no form nor comeliness. And when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. Well, how do you think Jesus looked after he had been beaten with 39 lashes and been spit on, they had ripped out his beard before? How do you think he looked like? He was ugly. It was just one mass of raw flesh with eyes sticking out of it and a nose. And it was prophesied 700 years ago, but we shall see him. There's no beauty that we should desire him. He's despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, and we hid his wild face from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. What a prophecy. We claim that today, by his stripes, we are healed. And then Zechariah, one of the last prophets in the Old Testament, Zechariah chapter 12, we read the following. Zechariah chapter 12, and we read it from verse number 10. And I will pour upon the house of David, upon the inhabitants of Jerusalem, the spirit of grace and of supplications. They shall look upon me whom they have pierced. They shall mourn for him as one mourns for his only son, and shall be in bitterness for him as one that is in bitterness for his firstborn. The Roman soldier pierced the side of Jesus with a sword, actually with a spear, to make sure he was dead. Blood and water came out. That was prophesied. How many years did Zechariah on this earth? Zechariah, about 500 years before Christ. 500 years before Christ, God said, they're going to pierce him. Another prophecy. And then we turn to Malachi chapter 4, the last book in the Bible. Malachi chapter 4, verse 5. Behold, I will send you Elijah, the prophet, to come before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. He shall turn the heart of the father to the children, and the heart of the children to their fathers, lest they come and smite the earth with a curse. John the Baptist was a man that came and prepared a way for Jesus. Prophesied here about 400 years before Christ. And now we go to Psalm chapter 2. This is a great, powerful psalm. I like that. We should read that for all politicians. It should be a song for the politicians. Why did the heathen rage at the people imagine vain things? The kings of the earth set themselves and they rooted counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, let us break their bands asunder and cast away their cords from us. He that sits in heaven shall laugh. The Lord shall have them in derision. Then shall he speak of them in his wrath and vex them in his sword with pleasure. Yet have I set my king upon my holy hill of Zion. I will declare the decree of the Lord has sent to me. You are my son. This day have I begotten you. This was written 1,000 years before Christ. I will declare the decree. The Lord said to me, you are my son. Today I have begotten you. Ask of me, and I shall give it a heathen for your inheritance. Adam's part of the earth for thy possession. Jesus said in Matthew 28, go ye out into the whole world and preach the gospel, teaching them to observe all things I've done, baptize them in water. And then in verse 9, you should break them with a rod of iron. You should dash them in pieces like a potter's vessel. Verse 9 refers to the 1,000-year kingdom. At the end, Jesus is going to rule with a rod of iron. And now we've got advice here. Be wise now, therefore, O you kings, politicians. Be instructed, you judges of the earth. Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling. Kiss the Son, lest he be angry, and you perish from the way when the wrath is kindled but a little. Blessed are all they that put their trust in him. That's us. We're trusting in Jesus. Kiss the Son. Now, 1,000 years, folks, before Jesus came, do you see the accumulation of the prophetic word given? And now we turn back here again to Zechariah chapter 11. Zechariah chapter 11. Just before. You guys have got a computer. You got it made. I flip. Zechariah chapter 11, verses 10 and 13. And I took my staff, even beauty, and cut it asunder, that I might break my covenant, which I made with all the people. God said, now, I took my staff, even the beauty, that's Jesus, cut it asunder. He broke the covenant. As it was broken in that day, and so the poor of the flock that waited upon me knew that it was the word of the Lord. And I said unto them, if you think good, give me price, if not, forbear. So they weighed for my price 30 pieces of silver. And the Lord said to me, cast it unto the potter, a goodly price that was priced to them. And I took the 30 pieces of silver, cast into the potter in the house of the Lord. Judas betrayed Jesus for 30 pieces of silver. Prophesied long before Jesus came to this earth. Matter of fact, 500 years before, they knew he would be sold for 30 pieces of silver. And then Daniel chapter 7. Daniel, the 7th chapter. Daniel chapter 7. If you pick it up in verse number 13. I saw in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of Man come with the clouds of heaven, and came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. And they were given him dominion and glory and a kingdom that all people, nation, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom that which shall not be destroyed. This is referring to Jesus and a thousand-year kingdom. As we put this together now, there are more prophetic words. One word was his bones, his body would be broken. But I have listed 14 prophetic words from the Old Testament about the coming Messiah. You and I now can do this. We can look back and we can read the New Testament. We got this list here. You cannot take the list, read through the Old New Testament, and you will find that Jesus has fulfilled or will fulfill each one of these. If just one prophecy, it could be questioned, but not 14, merging together. And here's what I want you to say now. We had two men before Jesus came to and proclaimed his kingdom on earth, Thoas and Judas, two false messiahs. We had a whole slew of them after Jesus. We still have this one guy now they're still waiting for. Menachem Mendel Schneerson. They're waiting for him to be resurrected. Now, it's pretty bad when you have the son-in-law, President Trump, believing this. And that's, and even had his daughter convert to Judaism, to Shabbatism, or Lubavitchers, to believe this garbage. Garbage it is. You see, Satan has a lot of power. Now, we don't hate Jews. We don't look down upon them. I feel sorry for them. They didn't get a good deal. Satan has been after them all these years, and he's still after them. And the only way for Jewish people to be saved is for you and I to love them and give them the gospel. They're not going to get it from the Muslims. They're not going to get it from the Mormons and Jehovah's Witnesses. The Hindus are not going to give it to them. The rabbis are not going to give it to them. Because in the synagogues, they don't hardly read the Old Testament. They read the Talmud or the Kabbalah. Do you understand now? When Jesus looked at Jerusalem, he wept over them because he saw the destruction that would come over them. So what we should do now is this. We learned last week that God is all-powerful, omniscient. He's all-knowing everywhere. He's in control. Everything was designed in advance. Now we learn the prophetic things, 14 prophecies that I selected, telling about the coming Messiah. Next week, we're going to look upon the incarnation of Jesus. We're going to look upon his ministry as we are looking upon the destiny of humanity. The destiny of humanity is Jesus and Jesus alone. So today was more of an information teaching. I gave you a lot of information, Jewish history and biblical prophecy. So this is something we need to learn, to know, so when we proclaim our faith in Jesus, we can say the Old Testament prophesied, we have the New Testament, they tell them what he did. And we have the Holy Spirit that works in us and make us have things happening. Miracles, healing, salvation, and so on and so on. If you listen to me today and you say, well, I never heard this before. I'm not really a Christian. I have not really made up my mind. But I think I want to be a Christian. You need to repent of your sins. And all you have to do is to simply say this. God, I'm a sinner. I'm sorry the way I lived. Forgive me. I'm going to confess right now that I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. I believe he died on the cross. I believe he rose from the dead. And I believe he paid for my sins. Come on in, Jesus, and save me. And he will. When we finish here, you're going to have Pastor Charles Terrell come. And he's going to spend about 9 minutes with you. You will see three crosses show up on your screen. Hear his voice. He will read some scriptures. He will pray with you to make sure that you are born again today. If you do that today, would you call us, write us, go to our website, get an address there, and let me know that you accepted Christ. I can rejoice with you. And to those of you that are Christians, walking with the Lord, some of you was new stuff here today. But here's what I would suggest you do. You got an outline. It's on the website. Print it out. Spend a week this week. Look up all these Jewish messiahs for yourself. Look them up. And you find them, this guy was here, this guy did that. They are all there. But you see, in history, we never learn about it because they don't teach us that. In church, you never know that. Then spend the next week by looking at the prophecies. Looking at the prophecies. Look up each one. Mark your Bible. So when you witness to people, you will know that you can tell them, here is the truth. Here is the truth. This was an educational teaching. And I pray to God that you will not simply say, okay, that was nice, throw the outline away. But if you do not study it, it's useless information for you. You have to study it, understand it, so it becomes yours. Otherwise, you're just like those that hear the word. And when the heat came, it dried up and they lost it. That's the reason the church is weak, because Christians do not study, do not pray, and do not seek the Lord. I love you. That's why I'm tough on you. And I pray to God that you will shape up. Some of you are shaped up, but the rest of them get shaped up. We're going to close, and you know what? Brother Thomas is going to come, and as always, he will close in prayer.
Father God, thank you for the word here today and the trip through time and the many different prophecies, Lord. It was very enlightening, truly a blessing. And this is the word that's going to keep us in the hour of need, Lord, that Pastor John reiterated that we need to study it and make it our own and to hide it in our soul. It's very, very important. So I thank you for that. I thank you for the upcoming message next week that is going to take us further down the road, Lord. And I thank you for still we have the ability to meet in peace in this country. We know this country has gone totally into wickedness. We see it every day in our surroundings. And so we thank you for the liberty that we still enjoy. And we don't want to take it for granted, Lord. And I also want to lift up the church to you, like Pastor John said. The church is weak because they do not study the word and they don't hide it in their heart. So we pray for a turnaround in this nation for the church. I also want to bring back what he spoke about for the political system and how it operates, which is right on the money. And that we should take time to review that also, because it is critical. It's always been critical in the times that people lived on the planet. The political system has always been operating in the background. We have it operating today, and it is wicked. I've been in the middle of it. So I thank you, Lord, for awakening in that area also, and for the Christians to be involved in the political arena. And I want to lift up one political prisoner. And he is coming before the Ninth Circuit Court this, I think it's going to be November. And I pray that all these evil, unsubstantiated charges against him will be dropped. And he will be exonerated. And that he will receive restitution for the crimes that were committed against him by the government of the United States of America, the FBI, and the Obama administration. His name is Francis Schaeffer Cox, named after the famous preacher, Francis Schaeffer. I thank you for being with him today as he's in that little Guantanamo prison in Terre Haute, Indiana, and that you would shine upon him. Let him know that he is... He's going to be a free man soon to continue the calling on his life. We thank you for this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hello there, friend. You might have some questions about Christianity. There are many so-called Christian churches out there. So what makes a person a Christian? How do you get right with God? And how do you know when you'll die that you'll go to heaven? How exactly does a person get to heaven? Does God have a standard? And if so, what is it? What I'm about to tell you will be the most important information you will ever hear on this earth. And your decision will determine how you spend eternity. As you continue listening, I will explain. The bad news is this. When we are born into this world, we are automatically born with sin. Now you might think of yourself as a good person. After all, you're nice to other people, you give money to charity, and you try to live a good life. However, everyone has sinned and fallen short of God's standard. So it doesn't matter how moral, religious, or philosophical you are. You've broken God's commandments, and that has separated you from God. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Now you might say, "Well, I'm a good person. Doesn't that count for something?" Okay, let's take a little test. I'm going to ask you three questions. 1. Have you ever told a lie? 2. Have you ever stolen anything? Even something insignificant like a paperclip at work. 3. Have you ever lusted after someone of the opposite sex? Okay, how did you do? Most likely you answered yes to all three questions, which means you just failed the test. You see, these three questions are but three of God's 10 commandments. Failing just one commandment disqualifies you from getting into heaven and has condemned you to hell. This is why the Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." You see, God knows that we are all guilty of breaking His commandments. That's why He said we've all sinned and fallen short of His standard. But you don't have to be depressed about this. I do have some good news to share with you. In Romans 5:7 through 8, it says, "For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commends his love toward us in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. You see, God loves you so much that he gave his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for the sin in your life. Jesus was more than just a good man. He was God becoming man and walking among us. That is why Jesus died on the cross. He took your place and paid for your sins with his shed blood so that you can have everlasting life. God loves you so much that he sent his own Son to pay a debt he did not owe, because you owe a debt you could not pay. Jesus bridged the gap created by sin between you and God. The Bible says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." You see, there are three places we can exist in this universe: earth, heaven, and hell. So when we die here on earth, we don't just cease to exist. We will step out of our physical bodies and go to one of two places, heaven or hell. God did not send his Son to condemn you, but that through Jesus you might be saved and have eternal life in heaven. God's free gift to you is eternal life through his Son, Jesus Christ. That is why Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me." You see, God offers his love to you through Jesus, even though you are a sinner. This unmerited grace is not something you can buy or earn, but a gift from God. As you're listening right now and realize you're a sinner, know that God loves you and wants to save you. All you need to do is repent of your sins and ask God to forgive you. The word repent means to change your direction. You've been running away from God. Now it's time to start running toward him. The Bible says in Psalms 103:12, "As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us." That means if you call out to God and confess your sins, he will forgive you. What Jesus has done in the past for others, he will do for you. If you call out to him, he will answer you. He won't look down upon you because of your past. And there isn't a sin so great that it can't be forgiven. All he wants for you is to come to him. He will help anybody who calls out to him. If you have sin in your life, God still loves you. If you ask God to save you, he will do so. It is important to remember that talking to God can be done anywhere and anytime. You don't have to be in church to talk to God. He will meet you wherever you are. As you're listening to me right now, if you feel a conviction of sin in your life, that is God's Holy Spirit moving upon you. Friend, you need to repent of your sins right now and call out to Jesus. You might not get another chance. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Friend, you need to make a decision today, one that will affect you for eternity. You have a choice. The road to hell is paved with good intentions. So act today. I would like to lead you in a prayer right now where you can ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior. Now you might ask, what you just said, exactly what does that mean? Well, if you want to start anew and have your sins forgiven, Jesus is the way. There is no other way to God than through Jesus. I'm not talking about being religious. I'm talking about having a personal relationship with the God of creation who loves you so much and is just waiting for you to reach out to him. That is what I mean by asking Jesus to come into your life and save you. Won't you pray with me right now? God, I confess that I am a sinner and that I need to be saved from my sins. Jesus, I ask that you would forgive me of my sins. I turn from them now, and I put my faith in you. Come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. I believe that you paid for my sins on the cross through your shed blood, and that you died for me and rose from the grave. Save me, Jesus. I know I can't save myself. Thank you for saving me and giving me eternal life and a place in heaven with you. Help me to be obedient and to walk with you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed with me and asked Jesus to save you, you are now a Christian. You have become born again and are a new creation in God's eyes. The Bible says in Romans 10:13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You see, you're not saved because you might feel saved, but because you have called upon God and He has saved you. Now, as a way to grow closer to Him, the Bible tells you to follow up on your commitment. Spend time with God each day. It doesn't have to be a long period of time. Just develop a daily habit of talking with Him and reading the Bible. Ask God to increase your faith and understanding of the Bible. Also, find a local church where you can worship God and seek fellowship with other Christians to answer your questions and support you. Be sure they use a King James Bible if you live in an English-speaking country, and that the pastor teaches out of the Bible. Plus, don't forget to share your new faith in Jesus with somebody else. After all, if I didn't make this recording to share with you, how would you have heard the good news? Finally, please contact us and tell us about your decision. We will send you some written material that will help you in your new walk with Jesus. This is Charles Terrell with European American Evangelistic Crusades. May you grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever. You've been listening to the weekly webcast of Pastor John S. Terrell. This message was the 34th part in the series, The Destiny of Humanity, and was entitled 14 Prophecies About the Messiah. As the Godhead was in the process of designing the creation, they knew the redemption plan for the human race would not be acceptable to Lucifer and his fallen angels. God foresaw that Satan would introduce scores of false messiahs to hinder mankind from accepting Jesus as their Lord and Savior. To counter this assault of the devil, the first prophetic word was given by Jesus after Adam sinned. Later, Enoch was given a revelation of the future Redeemer, and this knowledge was the basis for Job's bold proclamation that his Redeemer lived and would resurrect him at the end of time. This information was also the foundation for the wise men that came to worship Jesus after Mary had given birth. King David, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Zechariah, Daniel, and Malachi, all would prophesy about the coming Messiah. These revelations provided specific details so that no one could ever say they did not know Jesus was the Messiah. The only thing God did not reveal was the year in which the Son of God would finally arrive. Meanwhile, Satan deceived millions of Jews by using demon-possessed men at different times to falsely declare they were the Messiah. This message is available on CD and DVD. When ordering, ask for sermon number 1701. There are several ways to contact our ministry. You can visit our website at eaec.org. There you can read insightful articles, watch or listen to a sermon broadcast, and explore the online store. The web address once again is eaec.org. If you prefer to write, address your envelope to European American Evangelistic Crusades, Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. That's Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. If you prefer to call us, the number is 916-944-3724. That's 916-944-3724. Resurrection Life of Jesus Church is sponsored by European American Evangelistic Crusades, and this has been a production of EAEC. Thanks for joining us today, and until next time, may God richly bless you as you read your Bible and walk with Him.